This meeting is approved by the area, which is defined as curb, borders, and leaving down. 3 days after the Korean War started, I enlisted in the United States Army. I took basic training with 46 kids. Yes, I mean their kids. We were 17 to 20 years old. Many of us had not been cut off teeth for a career. After 8 weeks of basic training, we were in Korea. Reported to our units, and in 2 days, we were in combat, slugging it out with the enemy. Korea was not like the guerrilla wars of Vietnam and the Middle East, where the enemy hit, ambushed, or attacked and disappeared in the unknown. Korea was like in World War II. Battle lines were set up, and we fought in combat, face to face with our enemy. When our casualties was heavy, we would pull off the line, put in reserve for about 10 days for replacements and supplies, resupply. Then back on the line, slugging out grenades and bullets. Our worst enemy was the cold. Living in foxhole with only a wool undershirt and shirt. Long johns, cotton fatigue pants, and when the temperature was 25 degrees below zero. And that wasn't free weather. Every winter from November to February, the normal temperature was 15 degrees below zero. Sometimes in the Siberian winter blue, the temperature dropped to 45 below zero. We slept in foxholes without sleeping bags. Only what we had on. We slept one off, one on every hour. We slept only when we got so tired we just dropped dead. Sleep. You didn't get sleep. Until our body shook the hell out of us and yelling, "Damn you, wake up." There's many times when we have to shake the guy to get him up. You wake up and every part of your body is numb from the cold, right through your heart. Fall asleep when you watch, you're dead from a calling, sneaking enemy grenade. When you see a slight movement in the snow, you open fire. Next morning, a dead enemy is within 20 feet of your foxhole. When you put a bullet through his head, the ready-to-throw grenade explodes and rips him apart. Guts, blood, come flying in the air at you. Don't open your mouth. Your spit is frozen. It's a frozen ball before it hits the ground. You dig a foxhole. Was like breaking into a rock bed. We had to chip away to 18 inches of frozen ground with small hand shovel. The most important tool we carried hooked on the side of our wood bed. You lose your shovel, you're a dead pig. I saw a guy who almost just dropped off from the falls. I saw another guy rub his nose and fell off. First of those were common problems, most career that don't have tools. Sometimes we don't beg for money. We never brush our teeth because we can't carry a brush and we can't spray the water. We get a lot of fighting during the winter months. At the punch bowl, we lived in 25 below zero for 2 weeks and were attacked almost every day. Our dead were frozen by the night. In the morning, it was frozen still. Frank Schaefer. We had a bullet through the head. After the battle, I had to pull him out of the foxhole, frozen still. Our Tennessee regiment were frozen. We chipped away with our bayonet just to get some food in our mouth. Hot meals were never served. Christmas 1952, they were bringing turkey dinner with mashed potatoes, gravy, and cranberries. At that time, we were attacked. After the battle, we went without Christmas dinner. I wasn't sorry or regretful. I was glad to be alive until the next attack. Sure enough, the day after Christmas, they came at us. My platoon, tied in with the French, was hit the hardest. We ran out of ammunition, fought hand to hand with bayonets. A kid, about 15 to 16 years old, reached out his hand to me. I held his hand and kiss his cheek before he took his last breath. He smiled and nodded his head. He's 15 years old. He was my enemy. My bayonet was in his chest. I carried him back to our line and gave him a decent burial. My last word to him, brother in arms, I'm sorry, we're in the pit of hell. When we meet, we'll hug in friendship. Out of the 46 kids, only three of us returned to live our lives into old age. 43 of our guys, my blood brothers, were killed. The three of us, Joe Iona, Glenn Manders, and I, will have a reunion in Branson, Missouri this summer. Joe served two combat units in Korea, fought in Vietnam, was stationed in Germany, served 12 years in service. He was an altar boy in the Catholic Church, but was kicked out of school for going to class and drunk. He retired as the vice president of a giant pharmaceutical corporation. Madera served 7 years in service, fought in Korea and Vietnam. He retired as a school teacher. He was kicked out of school for going to class drunk. Joe has a triple bypass and uses a pacemaker. My dad had a severe stroke in 1975. His daughter will be chaperoning him to Branson. When we get together, what will we talk about? First, our family. Then we'll reminisce about a happy time. Fun stories like a time when Ken O'Leary, with his pants down and squatting over the hole. We opened fire with the machine gun. I watch him throw it on the hip, holding on his pants. No telling, he came back up the hill with the box. In my silent moment, I see their faces talking, laughing, joking, and smiling at me. Most of them talk about their mom and dad, sisters and brothers, their ever-flowing love for each other. Some of them confide their intimate moments. Some talk about when they were kicked out of high school. Many had an inspiration of going to college and raising a family. One of them was going to be the President of the United States if they let him back in high school. Kids who were given a chance to live would be with us here today. A special one of them saved my life by taking my bullet, a bullet with my name on it. The bullet smacked his head wide open. His brain splattered all over my face and body. I went berserk and earned the Distinguished Service Cross that belongs to him. Robert Charlie Miller. He's a tall guy you see in the photograph. After a bit. Another special guy in Yale, grenades, hit the ground beside me and saved my life. His medal went home without him. He was buried in a foreign soil. He was the kid who was to be our President of the United States. Tomaso Namba. Among the many patrol, combat patrols, one sticks in my mind. An idiot in battalion command post called up the radio. I didn't answer, but the enemy picked up the signals. Knowing that, I immediately took the high ground, form a defense perimeter, and as two volunteers for an outpost. My orders were, they're going to attack us in two places. The draw on the right and the draw on the left. One draw will be a decoy. The other will be the main force. The decoy will attack first, waiting on a come, then they'll attack us with the main force on the other patrol. They're going to hit us, five or more to one of all of us. We're going to need all the firepower we have at the right place. don't get into a firefight. Come back and let me know so I know where to concentrate on firepower. Kendalier and Yap volunteered. I kissed Kendalier and left Cheek, hugged him and said, "Take care, honey." I saw the moon and then we met the back. Sometimes later, I heard a firefight in their direction. Yap made it back. Kendalier, he said, "He's holding them back so I can get to you." The main forces, massing for the left jaw, didn't drop dead from a stomach bullet wound. After the firefight, I sent four men to bring Kendalier's body out. We buried him, Yap and five other dead brothers on the hill. I gave the last rite. I said, "God, take care of my brothers." Their graves were marked on the map and given to the grave registration when I got back. Arthur Kendalier and Dahlia names are engraved on the Maori Memorial plaque. If you go to Maori as a tourist, go to Maori Memorial and you'll see their names. Many more kids came and died on the battlefield during 3 years of service in combat. All the 3 years, I was wounded by grenade and artillery concussion about 6 or 1 times. I don't know. I never found. I never thought about it. All I know was that for all my concussions and superficial shrapnel wound, I was treated at Mass Hospital, that's a hospital in Carolina. Recuperated for a couple of days, then reported to combat duty. Most of the time I just walked away. I just got sick and tired of guys in there just bitching and moaning. I just went back to my company. In addition to concussions, I was seriously wounded 3 times. The first, I lost a kidney. A bullet tore it out. The second, I was hit by a grenade. My life saved by another one of my blood brothers, Juro Nishima. His medal went home without him. He's buried in forest soil. Where, I don't know. Today my body is full of shrapnel. I lost a hearing on my right ear. For 60 years, my right ear and the side of my right brain constantly ringing. Sometimes so loud that it did and completely dead. When that happens, I'm in great misery. The third wound, I buckled from 2 bullets. One knocked my steel helmet off. The other bore through my ammunition pouch, ricocheted on my helmet, up the back of my body, and lodged next to my spinal cord. That bullet is still in there. It's a souvenir. I've kept all my life. I'm probably taking it to my grave. It doesn't bother me very much, except when I'm sitting on a chair with my heart back, then I can feel the bullet. In those days, there were no such thing as jackets to protect us from shrapnels and bullets. All we wore was clothes, and the bullet would rip right through you. For three of my SWIA that seriously wounded in action, I simply walked out of the Yokohama 155 Army Hospital in Japan. Hitch an air transport back to Korea. Found my company, reported for duty, and went straight back on the line. Many times I reported on the line in a tick of battle. Like the one time I jumped in a foxhole, Joe Yoda yelled, "You're supposed to be in a hospital. What the hell are you doing here?" In the din of the firefight, I yelled, "Came to kiss you. Now shut up and feed your damn gun." Machine gun started to spit out dead. The battle was called the main massacre. Massacre because they came at us about 100-1. When I stayed in the foxhole, I looked over the machine gun that was fired. I could see the hill was just like an army of ants coming at us. Before we ran out of ammunition, we were ordered to retreat. We glanced at our ammunition box, kept a finger on the trigger, and yelled to Joe. I yelled to him, "Take off, I'll cover." He yelled back, "Go to hell." I yelled to him, "That's an order." He said, "I'm going to use polite language. Go to hell." But he really said it, he wouldn't want to hear it. Finally, I said, "When you get back home, tell my mom about me." That's when he said, "Okay." He was also born in a Catholic church, so he told me, "Well, this is crazy." He told me, "Take your gun, excuse me, man. Take your hands off the trigger," he told me. "And get on your knees." I got on my knees and he gave me the sign of the cross and said, "Look up in heaven," and said, "Take care of my brother." I kept firing. I glanced over, the last I saw of him was the backside going over the foxhole. 10 days later, I got back to the company. The first thing he said, "What the hell took you so long?" I shrugged my shoulder and made a face. Then he came up to me and he said, "Hey, you really got a mother?" I shrugged my shoulder. He said, "The next time you tell my mother, I love her, and tell my dad, I'm sorry I gave him a hard time." My answer was, "Joe, if you're dumb enough to offer your head for a target, I'll go home and tell your mother." Besides, many seek and destroy combat patrols. most of which I can't remember. The five major battle scars you would see are from Twin Towns, Chip Yongi, Wonju, Yinji, Punchbowl, and Hotbury Bridge. You'll see that the ribbon counts for one and four stars made it five. Twin Towns was my first baptism in battle alongside the French battalion. Our vision was so outstanding that for the battles, for all the battles we fought together, we shared our songs, friends, laughters, and solidarity. Most of them were from the French Foreign Legion and the paratroopers. They were really fighters. What they do is they stay in the foxhole and they shoot at the enemy like that, and they wait until they come right along. Then they jump out of the foxhole and do better than fighting. They care. That's what they really love, better than fighting. After Twin Towns, we moved up 5 miles north to Chip Yongi. The Battle of Chip Yongi for the past 6 years is a textbook study at West Point. In that battle, we were surrounded. The enemy launched 45,000 troops against our 5,000 of the 23rd Regimental Combat Team. For 9 days, they came at us, climbing over the dead as we cut them down with automatic weapons, grenades. When we ran out of ammunition, we just jumped out of the hole. We did hand-to-hand fighting, mainly with our bayonets. On the 10th day, we called it quits. We had enough. We left our battlefield stacked 5 high with 22,000 dead enemy and billions of maggots. The stench of rotten flesh just choked the air. It was like sticking your head in a barrel of rotten dead rats and keeping it there. We see rations only to vomit what we ate. We took off our combat jackets, cover our heads, and ate. But still, we vomit. Our loss was 1,200 wounded and 2,000 dead. All our dead were buried in foreign soil. Gruesome, but that's what war is all about. On February 11, we went to reserve to replenish our strength for 22 days. We had fun, we relaxed, we had hot food, showers, warm sleeping bag in a two-man tent on the bare ground. Then back to Army for the Battle of Wonju. In that battle, I was lucky. A bullet tore through my automatic RPG stock and lodging my pouch. Somebody up there was looking after me. At that battle, we broke through and crossed the enemy. From then on, we slowly advanced on to the 38th parallel. September 11, we jumped off for the Battle of Hotbury Bridge. My platoon spearheaded the attack, and we took our objective, Hill 851, but not without shedding blood. Out of 38 men, only 7 of us were standing on our foot. I was lucky. A bullet just grazed my head and knocked his head. My relief company A, with 240 men, lost the hill the next day. After they lost the hill, the battle raged on. It raged on, but we lost. In my service career, I have never worn any of the medals or the ribbon, except a badge of Avery, Vets to Combat Infantry Band. All I had to do was wear that. They know I've been in combat. Why do I have to show off that I've got a lot of medals? I don't want the medals. They don't belong to me. They belong to those guys who fought in combat beside me. Those guys who took the bullet and made the supreme sacrifice. Without them, the medals would not have gotten to my hand. The medals are the symbols of our comradeship in battle. The medal belongs to all of us. Our wounds are embedded in the glory of what they gave their lives for. I am only the custodian, the keeper. The French critic has been and still is a hot issue. Critics cannot understand that after World War II, only two generals were awarded the French Crew de Guerre. That's what I was told. And now a lonely master sergeant is among them. Procedures? No. Until now, I never knew I had such a high distinction in the face. And most of all, I don't care. Never did and never will. The medal and citations were in a cardboard box until only recently, where I had to prove myself. I have never laid any laurels on being a hero. I'm not a hero. The hero of those guys who gave their lives that I'm because I'm here today. In my eyes, they hold the honor of them. French prisoner. In theirs, as much as it is mine. We're all holders of the French prisoner. In other words, it's all. After I prove I'm not a liar, the medal and citation will go straight back in a cardboard box. I want to put it out here for you people to look at it and prove that I'm not a liar. They're going straight back in a box, but now is an ugly stain. The stain that I had to bring them out to prove that we, my blood brothers and I, are not liars. We still blood to earn our honor. Now it holds no meaning except His grace, really. I had to bring the Dante out to show you people that I'm not alive. They were not meant for that. Let me tell you what your haters have done. You have taken away the true meaning of our medal, the glory of those who made the extreme sacrifice. Sacrifice of you can live as American. The medals were not meant to prove that I'm not a liar. You have degraded our failure. You have tarnished all of us who fought for our country as liars and made us prove ourselves. For those of you that did it, what kind of demon are you? Here's a guy that comes out of the service. He's been through hell. Then you point your finger at him and you say, you're a liar. You didn't earn that medal. What kind of a demon are you? As I said, I will be a keeper, but never again will I look at the medals with the shine in my eyes and the silent, meaningful nod to my blood brothers. Yes, these medals were symbols of our sacrifice. And I will not tell Joe or Glenn what happened here. It'll break their heart. The first thing Joe will say, what the hell do you think we are? Calling us a liar. And Glenn will say the same thing. We're the three surviving veterans. We're the three people who just came out of battle. We were wounded, but we lived. The rest of the 43 guys that I was in basic training are buried in Vietnam and in Korea, and I don't know where. On the battlefield, we fought people like you, and here you are again. I'm not talking about the, I'm talking about the people who is tormenting me that I'm a liar. You people who are demanding that I show you the medal to prove to myself. What your battle cry, is to prove ourselves. To prove to us your failure. To prove to us you were a veteran. Prove to us you're not a liar. On the battlefield, we fought people like you, and here you are again. I have nothing but contempt for those of you, all of you, especially Mr. Garrett Paulson, who forced me to show the proof, or else. Mr. Hamid, if you're here, stick your head in the sand, bury it deep. This meeting is not what you said it would be, a circus, not by a long shot. By the way, Mr. Hamid, what have you done for your adopted country, except help toxic criticism at me? I've been to hell and back. Where have you been? And to those of you who joined the bandwagon and demanded that I give my name and give you my contact name and number so you can verify the validity, I've got better words for you. But I'm forced to say, go fly a kite. I know you won't stop stabbing me. You won't move the line. The evil in you feeds on my and my blood brother's failure. It was an honor to be a veteran, but now I got my doubts. Because I'm in another battlefield with hate people. The very people my blood brothers gave their lives for, and what their men stood for. The hate seed in our city of Pacific started when Reva Bryant, Audrey Cruikshank, and John Jones went to the King County Voting Commission, Julie Wise, to disqualify me for running as a white or as a write-in candidate. Yes, they wanted to disqualify me. They were determined to eliminate me from the race, maneuvering so that John Jones would be elected as your mayor. From that scene, it grew into a hate splinter group. Who are they? Where are they now? All I know is that they're trying to force me to resign or recall. On the other side of the coin, are you hating me because I'm Asian? I'm not a white man? That an Asian mayor is disgusting to you? Keep in mind, my blood is the same color as yours. I prove that I'm an American on the battlefield. I ask, what have you done for your country? Except stir up hate and trouble. Jeannie Fancer, you are the author of Pacific Residents News. I'm calling you out. Why are you heckling me, making innuendos, splitting hairs over whatever I say, criticizing whatever I do? I have read your emails to back up my accusation. As yet, you have not made any constructive statements, such as, yes, sir, you're doing the right thing, or we suggest you do this, or I have a suggestion, or what can we do to make Pacific a happy, comfortable community? To all your haters, stop hating. Hating is a festering, ugly disease. Take the advice from the majority of us in the Pacific. Get healthy. Pitch in. Put your energy building our community of healthy, happy people. Not tearing it down. Join us. Work with us. Challenge what you think is wrong, but also admit when you're wrong and move on. Make our community where the young can take their place. They are our future leaders. In closing, people of the city, keep what our veterans gave their lives for. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those words are the lifeblood of our nation, preserved by all veterans. They are your protectors, your saviors. From their sacrifice, let's build a future for not only our family, but our community. And also our country, the United States of America. To all your veterans, wherever you are, you have my deepest respect and honor. Thank you so much for serving. Thank you so much for protecting me and my family, so we may live a happy life. Thank you so much for protecting me. As I may grow older and enjoy my country, to all your veterans, you are the pillar of my heart. Thank you very much.
put on paper a little bit about his military service. He didn't do it to brag or to try to win an election, as he has been accused. Telling a small bit about his military service was only meant to make you realize what type of person he is. In fact, this is the first time the full story of his military career has surfaced. For the years we have been married, he never talked about the depth of his military history in Korea. What has surfaced not only surprised but also shocked me. Now I know his true feelings of why he kept the depth of his career in combat behind a closed door in his heart. The trauma is too great to even understand why. For these past several weeks, the pain for him has been intense. Now his military service is an open page, a page that was his and only his to keep that has been forced open to the public. How mean and inconsiderate can people be? No matter what medal or honor Cy looks at, all he can remember are the faces of Charlie. Charlie was the one that walked in front of a bullet and saved Cy's life. Wonki was his childhood friend he met on the battlefield of Korea. They talked for 15, 20 minutes. Wonki was killed. And all of his other comrades who gave their lives for the freedom we have in the United States of America, to uphold the Constitution and all of our freedoms that we take for granted on a day-to-day basis. Now I would like to share with you Cy's certificate for the French Coeur de Guerre given to him on the battlefields of Korea. The paper is 60 years old. The seal is barely visible. How it ever survived this long, I will never understand. Keep in mind that Cy was 21 years old when he was awarded the French Coeur de Guerre. But here goes. French ground forces with the UNO in Korea, order number 73. General of the Army Corps Montclair, commanding general of the French ground forces with the United Nations organization, hereby awards the following decorations, pending approval of the government of the United States. Order of the Division. Master Sergeant Herbert C. Sun, Company L, 23rd Infantry Regiment. And this is quoted. An excellent non-commissioned officer, particularly distinguished himself on September 19, 1951, when his company launched an attack against Hill 851 of Heartbreak Ridge. Around 4 o'clock in the morning, the enemy launched a fierce counterattack in order to encircle our outnumbered assault elements. During the savage combat which followed, most of the officers and non-commissioned officers of the company were put out of action. Sergeant Sun constantly appeared at the most exposed positions, encouraged the survivors, directed their fire, and showed them a good example. The personal actions of Sergeant Sun and his braveness demonstrated under these critical conditions, under mortar enemy fire, greatly contributed to the success of this action and deserve to be cited as an example for all. The present citations comport the award of the Coeur de Guerre for foreign theaters of operation with the Silver Star for awards of the Order of the Division. SP 73,586, November 10th, 1951. General of the Army Corps Montclair, Commanding General of the French Ground Forces with the UNO in Korea. When all of this happened, I got very upset. I was particularly upset When I heard that Mr. Holsey was going to try to become a part of the VFW National Council, I went to the internet. I wrote to the White House. I wrote to the Veterans Committee, one of the senators. I wrote to the National Veterans Council, the president of the National Veterans Council. I wrote to the National VFW. Within less than 12 hours, I received a phone call from the Washington State VFW. They're still on my recorder. And he said to me, "I can help you." So I picked up the phone. He later followed up with an email, and I'll read some of it to you. "Honorable Mayor Sun, on behalf of the Veterans of Foreign Wars, VFW, State of Washington, I would like to express the sincere apologies of VFW State Commander Carlos Almeida and myself. I can assure you that Mr. Holsey was not and does not speak for or represent the VFW in any way. In regard to Mr. Holsey stating he is a candidate for VFW National Council, that is nothing that we here at State Headquarters are aware of. At our VFW mid-year conference on January 20th, 2012, there were two members who announced they were candidates for that office. Mr. Holsey was there, but he was not one of them. On another note, Mr. Holsey was voted out as the VFW State Quartermaster Treasurer at our June 2009 State Convention. If you have any questions, you are most welcome to call me at the VFW State Headquarters located in 5. And this is from the VFW State Adjutant. Later, I sent him an email. I thanked him for his support. I sent him a copy of Cy's Curtiger and his Silver Star certificate. And we also stopped by and Cy met him. And here's his response to me. "Hello, Barbara. I had the pleasure of meeting your husband yesterday as he stopped by my office. He certainly is a terrific individual and a true American hero who absolutely does not deserve the treatment he has been receiving. Personally, for me, it was an honor to meet him." I have to add here that when he met him, he told him that he too had belonged to the 23rd Infantry Regiment, but it was about 15 years later when he was in Korea after Cy had been there. He said, "I still heard about you 15 years later." He said, "I assure you that the information you shared with me will go no further than my office until after the 17th of February. That was the Curtiger. I wanted it to be a surprise. Unfortunately, due to other commitments, I will not be able to attend the event. However, it is my hope and that of the VFW State Commander that we have your husband at a future VFW event to thank him properly for his service to his country and his community." That's just to give you an idea of what I did. I got a little carried away, I guess. Sometimes I do. I have to tell you that there was a fire many years ago that destroyed many of Cy's personal documents and awards. I guess that Cy should have replaced him at that time, but he didn't bother. There was also a fire in the Army archives in 1973 that destroyed 18 million records from World War II in Korea. Today, it's difficult to obtain many of the records from the Army archives. How he ever kept the couple that he has, I'll never know. Many of the records from Korea didn't make it back to the Army archives in the United States. When you are awarded a medal on the battlefield, it is difficult to keep track of the paperwork. And if you really need to see it, I do have requests where I have requested for some more of the documentation that we don't have with us today. Anyway, I'd like to end with a quote from Wellington because it sort of applies to this situation. I hope to God I have fought my last battle. It is a bad thing to always be fighting. While in the thick of it, I am too much occupied to feel anything. But it is wretched just after. It is quite impossible to think of glory. Next to a battle lost, the greatest misery is a battle gained. And I have one other thing to say, that because of all of this, I spent a long time on the internet. We didn't even know, we knew Joe Iota was alive, because I saw him the last time in 1988 or 1989, when he used to go to the 23rd Infantry reunions, but he hasn't seen him since then. He did call him recently. We didn't know about Medeiros. We didn't know if he was still living or not, but I did find him. He lives in Missouri. He had a stroke in 1975, so he's having a little difficulty with memory problems. They talked about 2.5 weeks ago, maybe almost 3 weeks ago now on a Saturday. He picked up the phone and they talked the first time in 60 years. It's just something that he hasn't done that much about. Anyway, you're welcome to look at what we have. And I guess if you have more questions, which people seem to do, then I guess you can take him to court if you really think that he deserves it.